The British are cruel to fat people, with discrimination against the obese at an all-time high. From mockery on the street to harsh headlines, fat phobia is gripping the nation. And to top it all, there's still no law against fatism in the UK. But a new breed of activists are on the march, who are sick of negative stereotypes and abuse. They're saying, we're fat and we're proud of it. And with Britain getting fatter, their voices will only get louder. Mandy George is a roly-poly kissogram. It's her size 20 body that keeps her in work, and she wouldn't change it for the world.
I'm not ugly. I actually happen to now think I'm quite attractive.
Susan Beaumont was sick of being the odd one out at dance class, so she started Bigger Fun, a class just for the overweight. She's quick to confront stereotypes about larger people.
I'm as fit as any other person. You know, you don't have to be thin to be healthy.
Big Girls Paradise opens its doors once a month in East London. The women who come here call themselves BBWs, or Big Beautiful Women. The average woman in the UK is a dress size 16. Most of the women here are size 26 or over. Linda Koch threw the first of these parties 13 years ago when she spotted a gap in the market.
Big Girls Paradise is party nights for big girls and their admirers. I used to be slim when I got married and I moved to America, lived in Vegas for 2 years and ate out for 2 years and then grew to a size 26. When I came back over here and I tried to go clubbing with my friends as I had done before, people sneered at you, they looked at you funny. If you got up to have a dance, people would laugh at you on the dance floor and that sort of thing. So I just decided that I'll have a nightclub, and we tried it and here we are now.
A big attraction at Linda's parties are the curvy kitten hostesses.
The curvy kitten's role is basically to show that you don't have to be big to be beautiful, but it does help. You can be big and be sexy. I just think they add a bit of glamour to the night. It just shows that you don't have to be a size zero to be glamorous, and they are glamorous.
One of the kittens is Ellie, who's a size 30. She works as a veterinary nurse in Staffordshire, but makes time to come to the parties every month.
Ellie's one of our more recent kittens. She's a big girl. She looks fantastic. The guys love her. She's really friendly. And she's what Big Girls Paradise is all about, really.
I've always wanted to be some type of model or something like this. I never thought I could do that because of my size. For years, I wouldn't go out. I couldn't look in mirrors. I just hated the way I looked. So I used to stay in a lot because I was frightened of anybody saying any comment to me. The worst experience was when I walked through the door of this one nightclub and there was a gang of lads there. They were all looking at me and I heard a comment say, look at the size of her, I wouldn't like to date her. And I just wanted to walk out. My friend told me to stay and to ignore it. And I tried to laugh it off because I didn't want them to see that they knew that they'd hurt me. But deep down, I was just shattered inside. Don't you wish your girlfriend was hot like me? I never used to dance because I used to think everyone would look at that big girl on the dance floor. Where here, I can't wait to get on the dance floor because we're all big and enjoying ourselves and letting our hair down and having just a great night.
Ellie's confidence has been boosted by all the male attention.
Men that come here do like curvier ladies, so yeah, you do get chatted up and you do have them flirt with you, and it does give you a nice feeling that actually people do like you the way you are and like your curves.
A couple of years ago I was a bigger guy. I've lost a bit of weight, but I was bigger, so yeah, I feel comfortable around bigger people. My friends know that I always date bigger people, so I'm comfortable with it.
I think it's just something that people are born with, much the same as being gay. It's the same sort of thing, it's just an orientation more than it is a preference.
James's girlfriend is Shauna. She's a size 34, and they met on a big girl's website.
My girlfriend likes it, I enjoy coming here. It's kind of a place where she can feel attractive and normal, and it's a place where I don't have to feel like I'm odd for liking a larger woman.
Well, basically, it's the women that I'm attracted to. I'm not attracted to skinny women. So, as far as I'm concerned, the women here are a lot more attractive than they are at a regular club.
Linda's keen to point out that her parties are respectable events.
I think some people may be worried about coming along because they may think it's something a little bit fetishy or something like that, but it is most definitely not that, not here. It's very, you'll notice, it's very classy, very professionally run, and our customers are definitely not perverts.
Linda's proud that at her parties, big women get all the attention.
It's really, really good to see people get up and enjoy themselves without the fear of being ridiculed. You can get up and dance and not have to worry about being stared at. Or if you are stared at, you know it's for the right reasons. Don't you wish your girlfriend was hot like me?
Walk.
34-year-old Susan Beaumont is a drug support worker from Blackburn. She's just set up Bigger Fun, a dance class for the overweight.
And your shimmies. Walk forward again. Walk forward. Rocks.
Susan's dad is a dance teacher, and she grew up always wanting to dance, but her size stopped her.
Well, I've always been overweight, always, ever since I was a teenager. And it does restrict you in a lot of ways from doing a lot of activities. You have a lack of confidence because you feel people are looking at you.
Last one. Eventually, her dad talked her into coming to one of his dance classes.
He was starting up a beginner's class. So he said, come along, make up the numbers. You only need to come for a couple of weeks just while we build it up. And I was absolutely hooked. And within a few weeks, I knew that that's just what I wanted to do. So he trained me to be an instructor and put me through my exams.
But when Susan tried to get her larger friends along to a class, she didn't have much luck.
And they said, well, there's absolutely no way because I'd be the beetroot at the back, you know, the puffing and panting and can't keep up. So I knew that even no amount of persuading that I could do would make them come.
That's what I'm doing. Like, I am a blonde.
So I came up with the Bigger Fun classes, which is an opportunity for larger people to come and get some exercise, have a lot of fun, learn simple dance routines, and hopefully get a lot fitter. But it's all in the comfort of being in a group of overweight people.
Are we ready? We'll start with a little warm-up.
The number of obese Britons has tripled in the last 20 years, and as many as 2 in 5 of us are now overweight. So it's not surprising that Bigger Fun gets a good turnout. One of the members is 56-year-old Rosie, who works for Blackburn Rovers Football Club.
My impression of a normal dance class would be something like Fame Academy, where they were wearing the lycra and the leggings, and I wouldn't have felt comfortable with that, whereas here everybody is similar to myself.
Don't matter if you're big, ginormous or whatever, because it's just good fun.
It's because everybody's not bothered about what you look like. Where if you go to a gym or a dance class, everybody's like looking over, look at her size. And I think it helps with the teacher being a bit bigger as well. And nobody's like judging you really.
1, 2, 3, 4, stop. And again, sit down.
I think it'd be really wrong to have an instructor who was really thin at the front of the class with a room full of 40 overweight people, because they'd be like, well, what do you know? How can you tell how I'm feeling? How can you deliver a class to me being an overweight person? Do you know what it's like to be overweight? Do you know what the barriers are? Do you know how I feel to actually come into this room?
Community carer Fiona agrees that Susan's size makes the class what it is.
If it was a thinner lady, I don't think it would be the same somehow. I don't know. Because whenever you see a slim lady doing it, you always think a slim girl's doing it in the lycra and whatever. But she's really relaxed and she makes you feel at ease and everything.
I'm a bit hot, hot, hot now.
Susan knows that as an overweight dance coach, she's open to criticism about her own health and the kind of example she's setting.
people might view me from my size and think that I'm overweight and unhealthy, when really I'm not. I'm fit, I'm active, my cholesterol's normal, my blood pressure's normal. So yeah, I'm as fit as any other person. You know, you don't have to be thin to be healthy.
She's adamant that her class is not a weight loss scheme.
It's not about losing weight, it's not about being really slim, it's about being comfortable in your own body. I've been to diet classes before, and it's not fun in the slightest. But doing the dance classes, it doesn't feel like exercise at all.
I'm here to get fitter in a fun way. You know, that's what I want to do, really. Not so much to lose the weight, just get fitter, because you can be fat and fit. Give me hat, hat, hats. Give me hat, hat, hat. We're all struggling with the shimmy. We're not confident with the shimmy. I don't know whether that's our size, but it's coming.
When we're doing the shimmy, it makes us
laugh,
doesn't it?
When we do it wrong.
You don't do the shimmy wrong, I do the shimmy wrong.
No, but when we do the steps wrong as well, it makes us laugh, because it's just the fun, isn't it?
Yeah. It doesn't matter if you go out a step. Some clever person's already in step and you just follow them, don't you?
You sort of have to waggle your shoulders backwards and forwards.
Let's have a shimmy. Get warmed up a bit.
That's impossible.
I think my husband will be interested in some of the moves. I think the new sex moves, really. Not realising the dance moves. Yeah. Anybody
else? Bigger Fun's not just about the dancing. It's also a place to socialise.
We're all kind of beginning to be good friends and we're like all just sticking together and we all seem to go wrong and we all clap each other and just laugh. It's like good fun, it's like companionship.
You can meet events organised then.
Susan knows from her own experience how important the social side of the class is.
I found with myself, I was really, really... I was isolated. I used to stay in a lot at night. I didn't like to go and participate in things. But since I got into dancing, I got into teaching, it doesn't worry me at all. You know, I can go in front of a room full of 40 people and deliver a class. I can deliver presentations at work, you know. It's you just gain confidence more and more that you do it.
Susan's hoping that Bigger Fun will have the same effect on the women in her class.
Well, I've not got a lot of confidence anyway in myself because of my size, and I just think this will give me confidence in myself.
What I'd love to get out of this dance class is more rhythm and perhaps to learn how to dance more, but confidence as well, because it doesn't matter what you look like. You don't need to be, like, slim in your lycra. You can just be any size and just enjoy yourself.
When people are overweight, they tend to isolate themselves in some aspects, in other areas of their life. And by just getting them out of the house and getting them moving, getting them mixing with other people, they automatically become more confident. So that will spread through the rest of their life.
By night, 29-year-old Mandy George flaunts her curves as a fat and proud kissogram at parties and nightclubs in Edinburgh. By day, she looks after her three-year-old daughter, Jamie, with her husband, Sam. 2 years ago, Mandy didn't feel happy with her size 20 body.
Before I started the kissograms, I had absolutely no confidence in my body at all. I wouldn't even go swimming, never mind take my clothes off. I didn't feel comfortable in any kind of tight-fitting clothing. It was always baggy tops, baggy trousers. Hair, I kept my hair quite long so it would like hang around my face so I didn't draw attention to myself. There was times when I hated my body. I just couldn't stand it, felt disgusting. Agreed with what everyone said about fat people, that they're horrible, they're lazy, they're ugly, and I agreed with that.
But Sam kept telling her that her body looked great. He tried to put her off crash dieting, which he knew would be bad for her.
I was more than happy with that, with how big she was. As I said to her, I didn't care what size she was. It's what, to me, was on the inside. And I said to Mandy, yes, but you could go on this weight loss programme. You could be a size 8. You could be a size 6. You could be 8 stone. That wouldn't be necessarily the person I fell in love with, because I would see that she's actually hurting herself and she is becoming unhealthy.
One Christmas, Mandy spotted an advert looking for a roly-poly kissogram. Now she was happier with her body, she thought she'd give it a go, and when she called them, they signed her up straight away.
The most popular outfit is what they call Miss Whiplash. Dominatrix, basically, rubber-ish dress, buckles. Always comes with something like this, basically, which this one is a flogger, but it could be a paddle, a riding crop. It gives a good whip.
The first time I saw her do it, I thought, ooh, this is my wife. But then after a couple of seconds, you think, I can't think about that. She is my wife, but I can't think of her as my wife as I would in a normal part of everyday life. I mean, she wouldn't do that to a person in everyday life anyway.
You don't know.
Exactly.
Actually, I'll put it on over the top where you can see it better. A lot easier to get out of, I can tell you.
At first, Mandy worried that Sam might be the only man who found her curve sexy.
For like the first 6 months or so, if someone made a horrible comment, it would get to me. Once I did actually come out of a job and burst into tears because of what people had said. They hadn't thought I was listening, so they were being completely honest and basically saying I was disgusting. The vast majority you'll get are from women that are of a similar size and similar age to me. From them, I think a lot of it's jealousy, and they're uncomfortable that all their hang-ups with their bodies are being put out there, that they have to face them by looking at me.
The crowd reactions put her confidence back on track.
People that you think they're quite prudish, they wouldn't approve, started saying, that's really good, you're so brave. And some of the guys that I was doing it for, it was obvious that they were happy about it, if you know what I mean. I know my body's not perfect, but there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not ugly. I actually happen to now think I'm quite attractive.
You don't have to take your clothes off to prove you're fat and proud. 11 years ago, Jo Morley set up Big People UK. She calls herself a size acceptance activist.
The size acceptance is, you know, looking at the politics of, you know, fat phobia, size acceptance, looking at changing society's attitudes. I've always been a fat girl, ever since I was little, say about the age of 6, I suppose, if I look back in pictures there, and I was the little fat girl. And I was teased relentlessly for it at school. And I grew up feeling I was a lesser person, I wasn't entitled to be happy.
Jo has often been the victim of what she sees as extreme fat phobia in today's society.
I was coming home with my boyfriend, walking down to get the bus, and a big stretch limo went past us, and there's these couple of girls hanging out the top with champagne bottles. And they obviously saw us because they then shouted over, "You fat bleeps." And my usual retort to anybody saying, you know, trying to insult me by using the word fat, I just turn around and say, "Oh, thank you for noticing." But as I walked away and I thought to myself, what gives them the right to say that to me and shout that across the street? They don't even know me.
Jo's activism takes her all over the country, lecturing people about size discrimination. Today, her audience is a group of sixth formers from a Knightsbridge girls' school. She's trying to convince them to change their attitude to fat people.
Hello, my name's Jo Morley. I run an organisation called Big People UK.
Jo wants to challenge some of the girls' preconceptions.
What I'd like you to do for me is to draw a picture of a slob.
As she expected, most of the girls have drawn fat people.
Just picked one at random here. Majority of those pictures were of fat people. So you see a fat person as a slob?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm a slob.
No, I see a slob as someone who doesn't take care of himself.
So I don't take care of myself?
Well, I don't know you, but I'm generalising.
If somebody was to call you a slob, how would that make you feel? Anybody? Anybody, if I was to say, you're a slob, how would that make you feel?
I'd feel upset and really hurt mm-hmm. and angry.
I think that no one has the right to call me a slob, but they don't know me.
Society assumes that fat people are lazy, that we're unmotivated, that we are stupid, we are asexual.
Some of the implications of that and how
the beauty industry reinforces it, the diet industry reinforces it, the media reinforces it.
If we look at the character Heather in EastEnders, what have you noticed about the way she's being portrayed as a character? Yes.
She's seen as a bit stupid.
And kind of a bit loserish. She's always the one that seems to be following everyone around.
But they don't do that to any of the other characters, do they? So it's just perpetuating and reinforcing those negative feelings about larger people.
Jo's determined to turn the tide of fat stereotyping. For starters, she's reclaiming the word fat.
I call myself fat, and I am fat. Lots of people will, you know, who are fat will go, oh, I don't like that word, don't say that word. Because most of the time the word fat is used to abuse people, to make them feel bad, to discriminate against them. And by taking that word and using that word myself, I've empowered myself and I've disempowered the bullies. I'm fat. This is fact on my body. Right, thank you for your time and thank you for your arguments.
Jo has to be careful her lecture doesn't encourage obesity with all its health risks.
There's got to be a boundary to where you kind of say, OK, being fat's fine if you're, as long as you're fat and happy, but being clinically obese is not healthy and it's not good.
And there's a mixed reaction from the rest of the group.
I have been quite narrow-minded towards other people, like people who are more overweight and stuff.
I thought it was interesting, and I learnt that, like, you don't have to, just because you're skinny, you're not necessarily fitter than somebody who's fat.
I just think what she's doing is futile, because I don't think society's going to change.
At the end of the day, fat people exist in this society. We're not going to go away. They will always be here. If we exist, give us some respect.
Back in Blackburn, Rosie from the Bigger Fun dance class is showing off the new moves she's learnt to her husband, Pete.
That's a beauty, isn't it?
Oh, well, we used to watch, well, we still do, Strictly Come Dancing when it's on, and he used to look at Alicia and drool over every week, and he certainly thinks that fat ladies can't do that. So I'm hoping to prove him wrong, and I'm going to dazzle him on the dance floor at the end of this course. Because every woman would like to be a bit sexy for their husband, wouldn't they? And you think I can't do it, but fat people can dance as well.
It would be nice when you borrow him one of her dresses. See, she always wanted to go line dancing, but I don't think line dancing was Rosemary Sing, you know.
I think I wanted to do something a bit more raunchy than line dancing.
Well, we had...
Because you watch the old ladies do the slosh, and this is a bit more, you know.
Yeah.
Didn't know I could do Latin. Well, I didn't. Mm. Yeah?
Yeah, very.
So I just come to realise when we were learning the steps, and then she put the music on, and I realised I was doing what Mark Ramprakash had been doing. I thought, just a minute, that's samba.
Yeah.
And I thought, I can do the samba.
As long as you don't want to play cricket.
Backwards and forwards. You can have a go. Me?
No.
Well, I can't dance on my own. You're going to have to learn.
She comes home and she feels more refreshed rather than coming home from work and feeling tired.
And smile. Oh, ole, ole, ole.
She's just a different person since she's been going. She has belief in herself now, and that makes a big difference to the family. Your battery's going.
Linda's arrived in Manchester on a mission.
Hi, yes. Can you tell me what the capacity of your venue is, please?
Her Big Girls Paradise party has proved so popular in London, she wants to launch it up north.
I've gone wrong again.
But first, she's got to find a venue.
After 300 yards, turn right.
The main thing is to get the venue right, to create the atmosphere for a perfect evening.
Finding the right venue for a party is one thing, but finding the right venue for a big women's party is a different story. Linda has to be very picky.
First of all, is to have our own private entrance, because our ladies don't want to be walking through another function. It's uncomfortable for them. You know, some people take the mickey, young lads, lager louts. We just need to be in our own private venue. Venues that have big windows at the front, it just isn't going to work, because people don't want to be stared at while they're trying to enjoy themselves and dance.
Totally, totally unsuitable. The windows, just too... It's not private, it's like a goldfish bowl.
If there's not one thing wrong with the venue, there's another.
Small toilet cubicles. It can be really, really uncomfortable for people, so we need a lot of space.
The day goes on and Linda's still having no luck.
This is just not wide enough. People in high heels would slip down the stairs. It's just, it'd be difficult to get up and down. No, definitely not. Fixed seating is just wouldn't work at all, because people, when they try to sit down in the seats, it's really, really embarrassing if you try to sit into a chair that you can't fit into. Oops. Oh. This is extremely uncomfortable. You couldn't spend a whole evening sitting like this. It just wouldn't work, not at all.
Finally, Linda thinks she might have cracked it.
This is excellent. This is more what we're looking for. It's just light and airy, a lovely room, suitable chairs, big tables, a nice open space. Just what we want, yep.
Today, size acceptance activist Jo Morley is on her way to the Equality and Human Rights Commission in London. She keeps hearing of fat people being bullied at work, and she's decided to speak up for them.
Somebody contacted me, it was a mother of a girl who'd gone for a job to which she was highly qualified and skilled for. The daughter happened to be fat, and when she got her rejection letter, it stated that there were concerns about her size and possible health outcomes, yet there was no health problems at all. So basically she was being rejected for the job because she was fat, and they can legally do that. It is the last socially acceptable prejudice in this country.
In the UK, there is still no legal protection against fatism as there is for sexism and racism. Jo's determined to get some answers from the Equality and Human Rights Commission.
Have you got a meeting with the mining?
No, no, I was just wondering if I could possibly speak to somebody, please.
I can try.
Thank you.
Hi, I've got a lady down here, and she's from Big People UK. I'm afraid they won't let me obviously see anyone unless they've got a meeting, but I'll give you the two numbers to contact.
And the contact name?
They wouldn't give me a contact name.
Okay. That's great, thank you very much. Can I leave this as well, please?
Yep.
It's just a letter as well.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
No worries.
They didn't let me see anybody, but I'm not going to let this lie. I am going to pursue it. I will keep going. Because fat people in this country need representation and they need equality. Fat discrimination has got to stop.
The roly-poly kissogram job has turned Mandy's body image around. She thinks it could do the same for other big women who struggle with their weight.
I think that there's a lot of women out there that were like how I was, that they don't have the confidence in their bodies, they don't think they're attractive. And to hear a group of 50 guys shouting, whooping, applauding, and saying to you basically, you're great, is going to build anyone's ego. And they're all missing out on this because they think that people will be horrible to them. If they just took that one step, tried it even that once. Because I always think you should at least try it.
There's one person close to home that Mandy would love to see try it. Her Aunt Ailsa is 36 and overweight. Mandy thinks she'd be an ideal candidate. The first step is to take Ailsa along to a kissogram gig.
it's fair enough explaining to someone what happens, but actually seeing it firsthand is completely different.
Aunt Ailsa has always had problems with her weight.
Hello. Hi, babe. Come on. Good to see you.
Hello.
Hi.
Mandy needs to convince her that the kissogram job will change all that.
You know, you obviously don't know how they're going to react.
Uh-huh.
So, sort of like, how do you combat your nerves? Because, you know, they might just freak out and go, oh, you know, what's going on?
If they freak out and they don't want anything to do with it at all, because I've had people run away, you just grab the mate.
What swings it for Ailsa is seeing how Mandy's body image has changed.
At first I just thought, oh, no way. But I've seen her confidence grow and she obviously really, really enjoys it. I think if I can sort of get over my own, you know, fears and the unknown, I think just that very first initial, you know, going out there into an audience of people, you know, just going out there and thinking, yeah, I'm going to have fun, I'm going to do this, and getting over that first night. I've got an open mind at the moment. Here we go.
Tonight's gig is a 30th birthday party. Mandy's been booked as Miss Whiplash. Mandy's enrolled Aunt Ailsa as her assistant for the night.
Hey!
Ailsa will get a close-up look at what the job involves before she makes her decision.
I can't wait to see you in action!
What does Aunt Ailsa make of what she's seen?
That was one thing I never thought about. Do they have a partner or a wife or something?
Yeah. Some of them, they really go for it. The wives or the girlfriends, they really, really go for it.
Yeah.
It's not cream in your hair. Hazard of the job.
Despite the hazards, it looks as if Aunt Ailsa's signing up to be a fat and proud kissogram.
It's got me excited. It's really, you know, made me think more about it. So, yeah, I think a couple more and, yeah, I might be ready to go. Yep, as I said, if I can do as good as you, I'll be happy.
In Blackburn, community carer Fiona is getting ready to go out. Tonight, the Bigger Fun dance class is going ice skating.
I'm going ice skating.
Before joining Bigger Fun, Fiona was too embarrassed about her size to do any activity in public.
A lot of girls who go to the dance class have all got a bit more confident now, and we're not bothered what we look like when we're dancing. Like, before you kind of feel self-conscious, but when you go to Bigger Fun, it don't matter, does it? I think the coaching is a bit off for us to skate in. I think they'll need it for health and safety. I think we'll need knee pads, elbow pads and crash helmets.
I'll tell you, I've got leggings on underneath as well. Extra padding.
See you later. Right, here we go.
Bigger Fun has kicked off a whole new social life for Fiona. She's off to give her new friend Sandra a lift to the ice rink.
Hiya.
Hiya.
You have to really bang your door when you get in.
Right.
Susan's impressed. 10 of her Bigger Fun ladies have braved the trip.
Eve,
She's all too aware that ice skating might be fine for teenagers, but is another story for overweight women.
I think the problem is, when you're overweight, you're frightened what other people are thinking about you.
Tracy, help!
There are barriers, for instance, getting down to tie your boots on. If you fall over, can you get up? Are you going to be like this waddling duck trying to get up on the ice, things like that?
Susan's main hope is that getting out and about will give her ladies more confidence.
If you're in a group of people and you're all overweight and they're all having a laugh, it doesn't really matter. You can just help each other up. You know, you're not the one that's isolated.
Right, off we go.
I'm very nervous about this. I haven't ice skated ever.
It's like stilettos with a couple of vodkas at the same time.
I really don't want to do this. Oh my God.
Woo! Help!
It's called the locomotion shuffle. Now, have you got a double brander?
You feel silly when you fall over and it hurts your bum. But you just get up, don't you? Well, you try to get up.
I don't think that's for me. I think I'm better at dancing.
In the end, not much ice skating actually goes on, but the girls do manage to get some line dancing in.
Oh, we were practising new dance moves, because it's dancing tomorrow night, so we're all having a dance. We danced neatly on the ice, didn't we?
Oh, we did.
Let's get coffee.
Coffee.
Susan's clearly proud to see her ladies doing something they'd normally run a mile from.
It was really, really good. Not the actual skating part, because that was absolutely terrifying, but just being the group. Everybody's really gelled, they're all really bonded, and they're all planning next trips.
Because there's a few of us said that we're going to have a few lessons, if they're cheap enough. So that's all happened because of bigger fun.
We've been talking about the dry slope skiing next. So that'll be really amazing, I'm sure. I really look forward to that one, honest.
Today, a hand-picked group of women are gathering at a photo studio in Stockport. As well as running Big Girls Paradise parties, Linda organises a calendar shoot every year.
This is the man who's going to make you look good as a photographer, so be nice to him.
Morning, all.
But this isn't the average calendar shoot. It's a big, beautiful women calendar shoot.
Nice little Father Christmas hat.
The average dress size of the women here is size 30.
We're celebrating the beauty of size, just showing that, you know, you can be sexy and big.
Nearly 20% of British women are now a size 18 or over. Plus-size clothing has changed to keep up with demand. Dowdy outfits are out, sexy dresses and corsets are in.
Last year, the girls all wore corsets. This year, I thought I'd give them a bit more of a free rein and decide what they wanted to wear. And it's worked quite well because they've all brought loads and loads of different things to wear.
Star Trek.
It's a bit of a sexy, sultry sort of theme that we want to the calendar this year.
Grab your hands again, Mel, and squeeze your attributes in. No.
Linda's aware that people might get the wrong idea about the calendar. There's a big industry for BBW porn, and Linda wants nothing to do with it.
And that's the secret to my success, is the fact that I've worked long and hard to keep away from any sort of sleaze. Our website doesn't link to anybody, because the last thing I want is to be three clicks away from porn.
I don't know how provocative you want it, sort of, but I was just going to say, just pull the straps a little.
Well, if they're too provocative, we just won't use them. That's all right, that's not too provocative.
Well, I was going to say the straps sort of down to there, perhaps.
Yeah, you can do that. It's just as long as you don't get anything more out.
Here come the girl. Here come the girl. Here come the girl. Here come the girl.
Lovely, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, nice, huh?
You look like a Moulin Rouge.
For Linda, this isn't just a business. It's also helped her accept her own size and shape.
Running the club. Yeah, I guess it's given me more confidence as well to accept the way I am. I've tried every diet going and I just thought, you know, I'm doing it for other people. It's part of my business to be big now.
She's also seen how Big Girls Paradise has helped the other women.
I feel really proud that it's something that I created. It makes me feel good to feel that what I'm doing makes people feel good as well and give these girls an opportunity to do something that they otherwise probably wouldn't get the chance to do.
Oh, something just gone pop.
Yes, I just went pop.
I think it gives them a real big confidence boost. I mean, some of those girls are absolutely beautiful, but they would never stand a chance. The biggest models that most people use are a size 26, and I've got girls that are like a size 34, 36 doing the shoot, which I think is fantastic.
Makes you feel really good about yourself, really nice. Feel sexy.
As their makeup goes on and stuff, they're just beaming by the end of it. You can see they feel glamorous and they just feel fabulous about themselves, which is really great.
Linda's seen a big difference in Ellie's life since she first met her.
Ellie has really changed. When she first came, she was quite shy and not sure of herself. Now she's fantastic. Everybody loves her. She beams with confidence.
Ellie lives in Staffordshire with her 12-year-old daughter, Chanel. She's come a long way since being taunted for her size at school.
I was bullied at school a lot. I've always been big, and it got to the point when I didn't want to go to school. So I'd seen on the TV about people stopping eating and starving themselves, and that's what happened. I just stopped eating altogether. Just lived on water for about 3 months to the point of collapse. I'd lost four to five stone in the matter of months. My hair was falling out, my nails were falling off. But people were also saying how good I looked, so it gave me the more incentive to starve. And then at school I collapsed and ended up being rushed into hospital, and that's when they found out that I'd been starving myself. I used to lie to people and say I'd eat my dinner and I'd not put it in the bin or I'd vomit it up.
Ellie had fallen into a common but dangerous syndrome of extreme weight loss followed by extreme weight gain. But she's made sure her daughter doesn't follow in her footsteps.
My daughter, Chanel, she's got no weight problems at all. She's very fit and active. She does karate 2-3 times a week, which I'm really pleased that she does a lot of sport to keep herself fit, because there's no way I'd want her to be as big as me, you know, because of the problems I have had in the past.
That's nice.
Back at the calendar shoot, Ellie's finishing off her last photo session.
Lovely. Yeah.
It gives you a buzz, really. You feel really glamorous on there and like a proper model.
Here we go.
I'd like to be August because my birthday is in August, so yeah, definitely. So I've got to talk Linda to let me be August. Miss August.
Here come the girl.
Tomorrow at 6 over on Sky One and Sky One HD, the contenders are giving it all they've got against the might of Team Gladiators. Find out who comes out on top. Back to tonight on Sky 3, though, for Road Wars next.